Hi friends, now we will start discussion on the second part of the module, energy production from waste through transesterification. In the first part of this module, we have discussed on the fundamentals of transesterification process, need of upgradations of bio-oil and other triglyceride containing waste, and we have also seen the need of upgradation of bio-oil and biodiesel properties. And in this part of this module, we will discuss on steps for upgradation and biodiesel production from mixed waste plant oil and grease and combustion of bio-oil or biodiesel in diesel engine. So, in the first part of this module, we have already discussed on the general flow sheet for the upgradation of bio-oil and other waste containing triglycerides. So, and we have seen that there are 5 basic steps which are involved for the whole process. The first step was acid esterification, second is transesterification, third is methanol recovery, fourth is biodiesel refining, and then glycerin refining. Out of these steps, the acid esterification is also termed as pretreatment step. It is under pretreatment operation, and we will be discussing on the importance of these individual steps and of the major role of these steps, and then we will discuss how to convert cooking oil to biodiesel and the grease to biodiesel. So, now let us discuss on the acid esterifications. As I have just mentioned, that acid esterification is also termed as pretreatment step. So, in this step, it is basically targeted to remove free fatty acids if available in the oil feedstocks. So, in the bio-oil or any other organic waste, if free fatty acids are available, so those free fatty acids react with NaOH if base catalyst is used, like say NaOH or KOH, if base catalyst are used. So, the free fatty acids react with this alkali and it is converted to sodium or potassium salt of these fatty acids, that is also called SOP. So, this SOP reduces the quality of the biodiesel. So, as per the reaction takes place, the triglyceride plus free fatty acids plus alcohol, then under the base catalyst it forms this sodium potassium salt of free fatty acids and then the triglycerides. So, this is not desirable. Now, to tackle this situation, if the free fatty acid content is very less, let us say if it is less than 4%, then no free acid esterification step is applied. In that case, additional amount of sodium hydroxide or potassium hydroxide is added. So, as mentioned here, if NaOH is added, then percentage free fatty acids into 0.144 plus 1%, and for KOH this is this one, and for sodium methoxide, that is this is a catalyst, in that case free fatty acids into 0.190 plus 0.25%. So, this is a additional amount of alkali used to neutralize these acids. But if it is say if free fatty acids content is higher, relatively more than 4%, then we need to separate the free acids first before the transesterification reaction starts. So, in that case acid esterification is important. So, to remove these free fatty acids, sulfuric acid is added. So, this sulfuric acid reacts with the free fatty acids and the free fatty acids are converted to, in presence of alcohol, to esters, that is desirable for the biodiesel. So, sulfuric acid is dissolved in methanol and then mixed with the pre-treated oil, the mixture is heated and stirred, and the free fatty acids are converted to biodiesel. So, that is the main role of the acid esterification. Now, the main role of acid esterification is to remove the free fatty acids or to convert it. So, there are some other approaches which also do the same job. One is enzymatic method. Some enzymes can do the same similar job, but the difficulty is that this is very costly and this is not a very popular option. And then glycerolysis, the glycerol can be added at 200 degree centigrade in presence of some catalyst like zinc chloride, so that free fatty acids is converted to monoglyceride and diglyceride plus water is formed. So, when the 200 degree centigrade is applied, the water which is produced in the reactor, it will be goes off. Now, acid catalysis followed by base catalysis is another option. So, in this case initially acid is used when free fatty acids is less, means say 4% free fatty acid is there. So, acid will be used to down it below 0.5%, and then it will be used for sodium hydroxide addition or potassium hydroxide additions. So, the second step, that base catalysis reaction, will go on. And this, how it can be managed, the 0.5% by acid and then by NaOH, this is possible because the acid catalysis reactions, there are two types of reaction takes place. If we add acid, then triglycerides will be converted to esters, as well as free fatty acids will also be converted to esters, but free fatty acids will be very quickly transferred to the esters, but trans esterification will be taking more time. Here it is given, say 1 hour is sufficient for free fatty acids to ester formation, but it is 2 days at 60 degree centigrade it is required for the trans esterification. Now, one thing is there, that 4% free fatty acids, or somewhere it is mentioned that if the it is 2% free fatty acid is the upper limit. So, whatever may be the amount, 2 or 4%, but we have to know the free acid concentration. The what is the free acid concentration? So, how can we measure it, or how can we measure the conversion of this free fatty acids, that is equal to SO minus SI by SO, where SO is the free acid content at the initial stage, and then SI is the acid content at any time t, and then this is the formula through which we can get the conversion of free fatty acids. So, S, that is your acid value, we have to know at initial stage and after certain time. So, how can you get the acid value? Acid, for the determination of acid value, some amount of oil is mixed with some amount of neutralized ethanol. So, neutralized ethanol is prepared as per the standard procedure mentioned in the protocol. So, then neutralized ethanol and the oil sample is added with phenolphthalein indicator and titrated against KOH solution. There is known concentration, known strength of KOH solution, normally N by 10. So, then titer point, end point is achieved. Then the acid value is calculated by using this formula. The acid value is equal to 56.1 into V into C divided by M, and V is the volume of KOH solution, how much we are using it. So, that is in ml, and C is the concentration of the KOH solution, that is in mole per liter, and M is the mass of the sample taken to be analyzed, that is in gram. So, that way we can get the S values and we can get the fatty acid conversion. Now, we will start trans esterification. So, and we will try to understand what is the importance of trans esterification. So, this is the reaction through which triglyceride is converted to glycerol and fatty acids esters, alkyl esters of the fatty acids. So, this is our main reaction for the conversion of bio oil or other organic triglyceride containing organic waste to biodiesel. So, here the catalyst is required, as you have discussed in the previous part of this module, that the catalyst may be acid catalyst, base catalyst, that is those are homogeneous catalyst, or heterogeneous catalyst may be. So, homogeneous catalyst, particularly the base catalyst, it has more performance, but it has major drawback that it produces soap. So, it is not desirable. So, heterogeneous catalysts are getting more interest nowadays, and developments are going on to produce heterogeneous catalyst to make the process more efficient. So, if we use the acid esterification process, then there will be chance of some extra acid present in the output of this step, which is entering in the trans esterification reactor. So, we have to add additional amount of NaOH if we use the alkali catalysis process for trans esterification. And now, we will see what are the factors that can influence the performance of the transesterification process. So, here reaction temperature, reaction time, alcohol to mole ratio of the oil, and then catalyst concentration, and then free fatty acid content, mixing, water content, types of alcohol, and finally the catalyst type. So, all those factors or the parameters influence the performance of the transesterification reactions. So, what solvent we are using, that means what alcohol we are using, that will help what will be the temperature, and more the time more conversion will be taking place. And most important is the catalyst. As we have discussed, that heterogeneous catalysts are getting more interest because the homogeneous catalyst like base catalyst are having some typical problem. So, I will show you some example of the use of heterogeneous catalyst and different types of feedstocks, that is different types of bio oil, so waste cooking oil. So, from this we can get some idea about the range of different parameters which have been investigated. So, here temperature range is basically 60 to 65 is normal case, but in some cases here we are getting 80 degree centigrade. So, alcohol to oil ratio, if you see 12 is to 1. In our reaction we have seen that 1 mole of triglyceride reacts with 3 mole of alcohol, but in actual case the ratio is not 3 is to 1, it is more than that, that is 12 is to 1, somewhere it is 30, somewhere it is 100. So, normally in most of the cases 10 to 9, 12, these ratios are used. And then catalyst loading is, we can see here the various amount of catalyst has been used ranging from 3% to 10%. So, 4, 5, 6% are normally used, and reaction time is also varying. So, maximum 8 hours, so 0.5 hours to 8 hours in this table we are seeing. Yield we are also getting different, then is 25% to around 92%. Now, we will discuss on methanol recovery. So, in transesterification process we will get the products, the bio oil or triglyceride is converted to diesel products, that is the fatty acid alkyl esters, and then also some glycerol is formed, and unreacted methanol that will be present in the product, and that has to be separated because that can be used again for this process. And then biodiesel refining, biodiesel will be obviously containing say the alcohol, say we have the transesterification reactor, so we are getting here biodiesel, we are also getting glycerol, we are also getting alcohol, those are not used. Some soap formation will also be there if we use here base catalyst. If we use base catalyst, so then there will be soap. So, we need pure biodiesel, we need pure glycerin, we need pure alcohol. So, these three pure components we need. So, biodiesel refining is necessary because these impurities has to be removed, moisture, there will be water will also be there. So, that water, small amount of water may be present, so that has to be removed. Now, why the glycerin refining, what is the role of this step? The role of this step is to get more pure glycerol from this, we will be getting more pure form. So, we need to develop some methods through which we can get it. So, there is a series of operations are there and we can get 99% or higher purity of glycerol. Now, we will discuss biodiesel production from mixed waste plant oil. So, here we see waste cooking oil we have as a feedstock, we want to produce biodiesel from waste cooking oil. So, our first step is screening. So, we will be screening it to remove any floating material on it, then the clean waste oil we will be having and we will store it in a vessel. So, this cleaned waste oil will be pumped to the feed tank. This feed tank may be filled up to say 80% of its volume, then it is maintained at say 50 to 60 degree centigrade temperature and pretreatment agents are added here. It also includes 5 to 10% of crude glycerin in some cases. So, 5 to 10% crude glycerin if it is added, that helps to prevent the solidifications of the feedstock, and pretreatment agents helps to convert free fatty acids to soap, and then ultimately we will get the soap here. So, that soap will be sedimented here. So, separation is required. So, for this we need initial stirring first. So, some stirring will be there in the feed tank, and then we have to allow certain time for the settling of the particles or the sludge will be produced here. So, the temperature already I have mentioned, that is 50 to 60 degree centigrade, and around 20 minutes stirring is there is required, and then around 1 hour time is given for the sedimentation. Then the output from this feed tank, that is heated to around the 70 degree centigrade, and then it mixed with sodium hydroxide and methanol solution. So, methanol tank, in the methanol tank sodium hydroxide catalyst is used, and the ratio is around say 4.7% of sodium hydroxide is added in the methanol tank with respect to its the volume of the methanol, and then it is mixed with the heating oil which is coming here. Now, this temperature is around say 50 degree, and that NaOH addition produces some heat here, and that heat makes it suitable to raise the temperature to around 50 degree centigrade. So, 50 and 70 degree centigrade these materials are mixed, and then it is sent to the transesterification reactor. So, in the transesterification reactor, it may be of different types. The tubular, if it is a tubular type of reactors, the typical time is around half an hour, and the temperature is a 65 degree centigrade, 60 to 65 degree centigrade in the transesterification reactor. So, here the basic reactions takes place for the transesterification. So, triglyceride is converted to glycerol, and the fatty acid esters, alkyl esters, and then some unconverted alcohol is there, catalyst are there. So, we need to purify this product. So, the product which we are getting here, the product is coming out, it will be having the full of impurities. So, we need to remove the impurities from our desirable product. Our desirable product is your first is biodiesel, second is the glycerol, and third one is also methanol, if we use methanol for this esterification reaction. Then the product, it is going to glycerin separator. So, glycerin separator, how this can be? If we think about the different three major components, so biodiesel, glycerol and alcohol, out of these it has maximum density, rho is maximum, then this and then this alcohol. So, on the basis of the density, we will get different layers. So, the crude glycerin separator can work on the basis of separation in the density, and the crude glycerin will come from the bottom part, and from the top we will be getting the biodiesel, and methanol will be present in both the cases, as catalyst will be present in both the streams, and your additional catalyst will be present, and soap, if some soap is formed in the reaction, that will also be present in both the streams. So, we need further purification of both the streams, that is biodiesel stream and that is glycerin stream. So, for this purpose the biodiesel is first forced pass through the warm water tank. So, warm water tank helps the vaporizations of the alcohol or methanol particularly which is present here from the biodiesel, and then it is going to warm water wash tank. So, we use warm water to wash it, so that the soap is there, catalyst is there. So, all those materials will come into water phase. So, catalyst and soap will come into water phase and we will be getting the biodiesel in different phase, and then the, when it is biodiesel is coming to settling tank. So, if we allow some time here, so then if there is some other materials, impurities present in this biodiesel, that can also get some chance to settle. And in both the cases we are using zinc sulphate, and zinc sulphate helps to break the emulsion. So, water, alcohol and biodiesel emulsion, that is broken down by this, the presence of zinc sulphate, and more wastewater is generated, and this is the output of the settling tank that is purified and again sent to this warm water wash tank, which helps for the purification. Then from the settling tank we get apparently pure biodiesel, but this is not very pure, it is also requires some further treatment, and it is sent to crude biodiesel tank. So, in crude biodiesel tank we add 0.5% glycerin and 0.3% activated white earth. So, these two are used, the main purpose is to get the sediments separated from this mixture, and if we need further purification we can send it through some filters, and the paper filters like this, and we can get the biodiesel. So, here we have we need here say around say certain time, we need say 15 minutes of stirring and overnight its settling time for the process of the separation of the sediments from the crude biodiesel tank. So, this is the overall flow sheet for the production of the biodiesel from mixed waste plant oil. So, these are the in this slide the pretreatment of waste mixed oils, how the pretreatment is done, it is given in details, already we have discussed. Now, esterification process we have also discussed, it is given some detail, and then these are things are already we have discussed. Now, we are going to glycerin recovery. So, in the flow sheet we have seen that here we are getting glycerin, and then this stream is for biodiesel and its purification, and here we have not shown any steps for crude glycerin separation, but you see what is the composition in crude glycerin. So, glycerin, methanol, catalyst, soap basically, and to some extent moisture if any in the feedstock. So, that is the composition of this crude glycerin. So, we have to separate. So, again the bulk, if we heat it, if we heat this one the whole mixture, then methanol will goes off. Methanol will goes off, then we need to separate catalyst and soap and H2O. So, first step of this glycerin purification is that it is stored in neutralization tank and neutralization tanks, and then it is glass lined and equipped with a closed type agitator, and then it is heated under normal pressure to out the methanol. After that, when methanol is being out, we are having these things and soap is also there. If we add some acid, say HCl, so soap will be converted to ester, and again it will form one oil and it will goes to the top of this mixture. If we have glycerin mixture, so HCl is added, so some oil will form here because the soap will be converted to esters, and then we will get some oil, and that oil is separated and used for other applications. Then the next part which we are getting, that is basically having H2O and catalyst. So, when we will neutralize the catalyst, sodium hydroxide part is also removed. So, then crude glycerin is taken from the bottom of the neutralization tank and pumped first to the crude glycerin tank and then to the crude glycerin concentrator for further treatment. So, after that, after this HCl treatment and removing of this upper part of that oil we will getting relatively purer glycerin, but still if we need more purification of this, then we have to go for further steps. So what are those further steps? Then we can go for vacuum distillation. We can go for vacuum distillation. If we need further purification, the vacuum, then we can go for addition of activated carbon. Activated carbon, if we use, add, if we allow certain time here, so the activated carbon will capture all the impurities present in the glycerin, particularly the colors, and it requires a 15 minute stirring at 90 to 100 degree centigrade temperature. And the requirement of activated carbon is around 2 to 3% of the total glycerin which is present. So that way we can get the 99.5% pure glycerin. Now we will see one flow sheet for the conversion of grease, or where the fatty acid content is higher, to biodiesel. At first the feedstocks is coming into the esterification, that is acid esterification step, acid catalysis is used, and then the free fatty acid is converted to esters, and then it is coming, it is neutralization, acid is neutralized, then it is coming for separation, and then we are adding some base catalyst, and then transesterification reaction is going on, then we are getting the products, the product separation is going, from the bottom we are getting the glycerin part, from the top we are getting biodiesel and alcohol. Then this is separated here by distillations, and biodiesel and methanol are going from the top part. So this alcohol or methanol again used for these reactions, and from the bottom we are getting the glycerin, which is being purified, and catalyst are being regenerated. We are getting the catalyst, Spain catalyst. So this is the flow sheet with respect to the conversion of high fatty acid containing oil to biodiesel. This is the biodiesel. Now we will discuss how this biodiesel can be combusted or can be used in engine, particularly the diesel engine. So in diesel engine, what happens when the fuel, diesel fuel, is put through the nozzles in the cylinder? So droplets are formed. So these droplets, particularly 5 to 20 microns range, as shown here. So if this is a nozzle, the liquid fuel is passing through it. So here we will be having the 5 micrometer particles, and if we move towards this nozzle, so the diameter is also increased. So 20 to 5 micrometer, this is the normal range of the droplets which is generated in the cylinder. Now if we use the biodiesel, so due to its high viscosity, the droplet size will be higher. At first, due to high viscosity, the nozzles will not be that much efficient, so it will not be able to spray it and to make the droplets. And secondly, if it is possible, then the diameter will also be higher. So higher the diameter, it will restrict the full combustion. So there will be some deposition of coke, and due to the deposition of coke, there will be many problems in the engine. That is why the blends are used. The 20 B20, like say 20% biodiesel and 80% diesel. So more deposits inside the engine cause poor engine performance, resulting from low compression due to sticking piston rings or coke valves, and deposits on the injector nozzle. If injector nozzle there is some coke deposition, then that will not be able to inject the materials or the produce the droplets efficiently. And there will be some damage on the engine and lower the performance of the engine. Then what is the remedy of it? The research is going on to improve on engine side as well as on oil side, and one of such efforts, that is twin tank or dual fuel system. So dual fuel system and twin tank means, in this case, the conventional diesel and biodiesel, both are used in separate tank. So there are two separate tanks, one is for conventional diesel and another is for biodiesel. So from the conventional biodiesel, and this is a diesel, petrodiesel, So, it is coming and is going to the combustion chamber. So, this combustion chamber at the initial stage or the starting of the engine will be using this fuel. It will be combusted here, heat will release, waste heat will be used for the waste heat will be used to raise the temperature here. So, temperature will increase. Once the temperature is increased to sufficient extent, then its viscosity will get down and it will get the flowability, and at that time its flow will start. It will go through this, and there will be one valve, three way valve. So, that three way valve will manage the flow from this tank or this tank. And when we will stop the engine, again we will stop this line, then this line will open, and 4-5 minutes will be this diesel will be used, so that there will be no choking inside the lines, it will be clear. So, for further applications there will be no difficulty. So, this is one of the important development on the engine, that is twin tank or dual fuel system. So, that way to some extent the difficulty or the disadvantage of the biodiesel is tackled. So, up to this in this module, thank you for your patience.